In the years leading up to the dissolution of the Rhodesia and Nyasaland Federation, it had become vividly clear that colonialism was in its last days. Many countries on the African continent had attained independence.
If you like the content on this channel, please consider partnering with me on Patreon. From as little as $3, you can help me improve the quality and consistency of videos on this channel. On that note, help me thank my biggest Patreon, Tom Bodkin. Thank you so much for the continued support.
Sensing the wheels of change and growing international pressure, Britain had adopted a pro-African majority rule stance in all its colonies. African nationalist movements in Northern Rhodesia, which is modern-day Zambia, led by Kenneth Kaunda, and Hastings Kamuzubanda in Nyasaland, which is modern-day Malawi, as well as the decolonization movement on the continent, had made the white minority government in Southern Rhodesia very uneasy. Plans to declare independence from Britain were already in place as early as the 1930s. Likewise, Britain had made several overtures to the Southern Rhodesian government, led by Prime Minister Godfrey Huggins, hinting at the possibility of the inclusion of blacks in governance, the model that had been adopted in their neighboring colonies of Northern Rhodesia and Nyasaland. But unlike many other colonies, Southern Rhodesia was unique in that it was largely self-sufficient. That in itself would make negotiations with Britain for any matter a tad bit difficult. Many scholars believe that the idea of a federation itself was a last-ditch attempt at trying to delay the winds of change on the continent. In his last year in office in 1956, Huggins, aka Sir Lord Malvern, asked Britain to make the federation a domain so it could join other countries that had received dominion status, namely Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. But that bid failed as well. Back home, the white opposition through the Dominion Party as a response began calling for a unilateral declaration of independence. At this point, Britain had adopted the idea of no independence before majority rule, commonly abbreviated NIBMA. When it became evidently clear that the federation was headed towards a dissolution, the Southern Rhodesian government brokered the 1961 constitution with Britain through their prime minister, Sir Edgar Whitehead, which he thought would remove British powers over Southern Rhodesia. However, the final version of the constitution included a few extra provisions inserted by the British, one of which, section 111, which reserved full powers to the crown to amend, add to, or revoke certain sections of the Southern Rhodesian constitution by order in council at the request of the British government. This effectively negated the relinquishment of British powers described elsewhere in the document. But the Southern Rhodesians did not initially notice it. The constitution was presented and sold to the voting minority in Southern Rhodesia as an independence constitution. It went to a referendum and was approved on the 26th of July, 1961. But only after white dissenters, which included Ian Douglas Smith, who was chief whip of the governing United Federal Party, who resigned because the proposed constitution omitted an explicit promise of Southern Rhodesian independence. Black nationalist movements activity in Southern Rhodesia had started in the 1950s. One prominent name that emerged was the nationalist group Zimbabwe African People's Union, ZAPU, which was led by Joshua Nkomo. Facing opposition from the newly formed Rhodesian Front, a newly formed alliance of conservative voices led by Winston Field and Ian Smith, Sir Edgar Whitehead attempted to win black support by proposing reforms to racially discriminatory legislation, something that whites in Southern Rhodesia were opposed to. But ZAPU convinced the prospective African voters not to. Subsequently, Fields and Smith's Rhodesian Front would emerge victorious in the 1962 Southern Rhodesian elections. The Rhodesia and Nyasaland Federation was eventually dissolved following several meetings by all stakeholders, including the British. By the end of December 1963, it was non-existent, but not before the British had in October 1963 announced that Nyasaland would become independent on the 6th of July, 1964. This announcement rattled the Southern Rhodesian government, who anticipated that Northern Rhodesia would follow suit and eventually all eyes would be on Southern Rhodesia. The Rhodesian Front-led government responded by sending Ian Smith to Britain to try and fight for independence in a series of talks with the new British Prime Minister, Sir Alec Douglas-Home. but nothing fruitful came out of it. Joshua Nkomo's ZAPU would eventually split and as a result form a new party called ZANU on the 8th of August 1963, further complicating the equation for the Southern Rhodesian white minority government. Though there were some who were sympathetic to the white minority government in Southern Rhodesia, in Britain, international pressure forced their hand as a result of the geopolitical and moral shifts associated with the winds of change. The issue had gained a lot of attention globally, with pressure from bodies like the UN and the Organization of African Unity calling for independence of all African colonies. The Rhodesian Front under Fields and Smith were trying to broker a deal with the Conservatives before the next British elections, which were largely in favor of the Labour Party, who were very much opposed to Southern Rhodesia's independence plans. In trying to convince the British, the Rhodesian Front claimed that the bloody civil wars, military coups, and other disasters that plagued the new majority ruled African states to the north, many of which had become corrupt, autocratic, or communist one-party states very soon after independence, showed that black Rhodesian leaders were not ready to govern. Back in Southern Rhodesia, Fields' failure to secure independence concurrently with the end of the Federation caused the cabinet's support for him to waver during the 1963 and early 1964. The Rhodesian Front Caucus in January 1964 revealed widespread dissatisfaction with him on the grounds that the British seemed to be outwitting him. The Prime Minister was put under immense pressure to win the colony's independence. He attempted to remedy this, but the British proved to be a difficult rival. He was eventually forced to resign on the 13th of April, 1964. Ian Douglas-Smith accepted the cabinet's nomination to take his place as Prime Minister. Smith was more of a hardliner, and it did not take long. A stalemate developed between the British and Rhodesian Prime Ministers, Harold Wilson, the leader of the Labour Party, and Ian Smith, respectively, between 1964 and 1965. The dispute largely surrounded the British condition that the terms for independence had to be acceptable to the people of the country as a whole. Smith contended that this was met, while the UK and black Rhodesian leaders held that it was not. After Wilson proposed in late October 1965 that the UK might safeguard the future black representation in the Rhodesian Parliament by withdrawing some of the colonial government's devolved powers, then presented terms for an investigatory royal commission that the Rhodesian found unacceptable, Smith and his cabinet declared independence. The unilateral declaration of independence was officially adopted by the cabinet of Rhodesia on the 11th of November 1965, announcing that Rhodesia, a British territory since 1923, now regarded itself as an independent sovereign state. The British, in response, called this treasonous and imposed sanctions on Southern Rhodesia. The international community followed suit, and Southern Rhodesia was left isolated, with support coming only from South Africa and Portugal. Southern Rhodesia would later be plunged into the Bush War, known as the Second Chimurenga, eventually leading to the Lancaster House Conference and then Zimbabwe's independence. If that's a video that you'd like me to work on, let me know in the comment section below.